Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the dignitaries of IMA Kodambakkam for giving me this opportunity. The topic which was given to me was emergencies in ENT, which let's say is such a big topic that it's not possible to cover it within 30 minutes. So I have, after speaking to Chandrasekhar sir, I have decided to condense it, and the topic which I have covered in this are just only the common ENT emergencies which an ENT surgeon or a GP encounters on a daily basis. So it's an irony that this is the topic given to me, because one of the reasons I had taken ENT was that I used to think that emergencies were less in ENT compared to the other departments. But after I had taken up ENT, I realized that there are a lot of emergencies within ENT, and the fact is that the ENT emergencies which we encounter give us very little time to react, because most of the time it's very patient. So we'll start with what is a medical emergency. It's just an acute injury or an illness which can have a long-term sequelae to the patient, or it can lead to the loss of the patient's life. So there are only two absolute emergencies in ENT per se. That is, if you are looking at all the emergencies in ENT, there are only two. The first one is airway obstruction, because any obstruction within the laryngotracheal path, any laryngeal obstruction, or any obstruction within the oropharyngeal area also, the patient can go in, patient can have an airway obstruction, and that can lead to fatal consequences. The second one is epistaxis. Though it sounds very common, epistaxis can kill the patient if we do not act in time. So this, we'll go to first what is airway obstruction. This video actually, the video is of a a patient of CA larynx. So the audio won't come. It's of a CA larynx who are presented with stridor. Now this word stridor is a word which gives a shock to all of the ENT surgeons. The moment we hear this word, everyone goes into attention and we start acting. We have to act quickly. Stridor means noisy breathing. That's because of any obstruction within the oropharyngeal or the laryngotracheal region. So when a patient presents with stridor, we need to admit the patient first, put the patient on oxygen, and we have to monitor the saturation of the patient. Initially we will start him on IV steroids, and we will wait to see whether the patient improves. But in many cases of proven obstruction within the laryngeal framework, like in case of the CA larynx, the picture which was there in the previous slide, we may have to do what we call the emergency tracheostomy. Tracheostomy per se usually takes only 20 to 25 minutes, but when we do an emergency tracheostomy, we have to do it within 5 minutes or even shorter. It is just making a hole in the trachea and passing the tracheostomy tube into the trachea, so that we bypass the obstruction which will be there above in this region. Coming next to epistaxis. Primarily, we usually see epistaxis cases on a day-to-day basis. Many cases we see, and there are a lot of causes for epistaxis. But there are only two basic etiology which causes epistaxis. The first thing is trauma, and the second one is hypertension. Invariably, 90% of the cases will be one of these two causes only. So again, in this, epistaxis is classified into two. One is anterior epistaxis, when the bleeding comes anteriorly, and the posterior epistaxis, when the bleeding goes behind into the nasopharynx. So despite the etiology, there are hundreds of etiological causes. Our primary aim is only to stop the bleeding. So we have to arrest the bleeding. Initially, we can pinch the nostril, and we can even apply ice in this region. So we'll wait for the vasoconstriction, and sometimes the bleeding may stop. But in many cases, it will not. That is when we have to do the packing, nasal packing, which is again anterior-nasal packing and posterior-nasal packing. In this picture, this is anterior-nasal packing. In this, you can see that we have used, this is called as a merosal pack. This merosal pack is actually made of polyvinyl alcohol, which will enlarge itself when you place it in the nasal cavity. So we can, this is actually really available everywhere. We can use it. And we have to push it into the nasal cavity, and that is how we do the anti-nasal packing. But in many cases, the bleeding may not stop. That is when the patient has got posterior epistaxis. So in those patients, we have to do a posterior nasal packing. So in our center, we do posterior nasal packing using the Foley's catheter. We pass the Foley's catheter through the nasal cavity. Pull it through the oropharynx here, encephalate it, and then we pull back the Foley's catheter back so that the encephalated region goes and gets lodged in the nasopharynx in this region so that the pressure over here can stop and can bring about hemostasis. Now coming to the other emergencies. Now there are some emergencies in ENT where we have to intervene in a controlled atmosphere, that is in the OR, in the theater, and the patient may have to undergo some procedure under general anesthesia. So what are those procedures which the patient may have to undergo? One. One is incision and drainage. Two, foreign body removal. And three, fast debridement with or without orbital decompression. So now we will come to incision and drainage. It is indicated in all proven cases of abscess. Abscess is a collection of pus within the body. So now, what are the abscesses which pose as an emergency to an ENT surgeon? We'll come to the first one, postoral abscess. These patients will come with pain behind the ear. They'll have swelling behind the ear in the postoral region. It will, most of the time, it will look like this. There will be a swelling behind the ear in the postoral region, you can see here. And this abscess, actually, it is called as a subperiosteal abscess. It will be underneath the periosteum of the mastoid bone. And most of the time, the patient will have fever with chills. These patients have to be taken up under general anesthesia, and IND has to be done. Next, we come to septal abscess or a septal hematoma. Now, in this, you can see that the patient will present with nasal obstruction. And when we examine the nasal cavity, you can see that there will be bulge on both sides. So, that means there is a collection within the septal area. It could be abscess, I mean, pus, or it can be even hematoma, a blood collection within the area. Most of the time, patient will have his prior history of trauma. So there could be an hematoma initially, which has finally developed into an abscess collection. And in these patients present themselves, they also have to undergo an IND. Coming to the other neck abscesses. Neck abscesses per se is such a big topic that it can talk for more than 1 hour and more. So I have shortened it. These are the abscesses which we normally see. Conditions where the patient have to undergo an incision drainage. They are the peritonsillar abscess, the parapharyngeal abscess. You can see the peritonsillar abscess is here. It's actually it's in the peritonsillar region, and it's also called a spinsy. And this is a picture of a parapharyngeal abscess. These are the cases where the patient have to be admitted and planned for an IND as quick as possible. Coming to the next entity, that is foreign body. Foreign body in ENT are of three entities. One is foreign body nose, the foreign body throat, and the foreign body bronchus. In this talk, I will not be focusing much on the throat and the bronchus part. It's more of a foreign body nose because this needs a separate talk itself. So we'll go to the foreign body nose. It's predominantly pediatric. And most of the time, in our day-to-day practice, we'll see a child who will present with nasal obstruction, nasal discharge, or sometimes nasal bleed. But the fact is that it will always be unilateral. So when there is a unilateral nasal obstruction with rhinorrhea or nasal bleed, the first diagnosis to be ruled out should be foreign body nose. And when we do an X-ray PNS, this will be the kind of picture we get. This is the foreign body hook which we use to remove the foreign body nose. And it can be done not only just by an ENT surgeon, by any doctor of any specialty. The only the important fact is that we have to hold the child properly. And obviously we must have a head mirror and headlight. So that the child has to be held in such a way that the child does not move. You can see that the arms are held tight and the right hand of the person holding should be on the head so that we can focus the light into the nasal cavity, use the hook, the probe, go behind the foreign body and pull it anteriorly. Next, coming to the foreign body throat or foreign body esophagus. This is also fairly common emergency we encounter. These are some of the pictures of the foreign bodies we have removed in the last 1 or 2 months. And commonly among children, it has been the coin, which is the commonest foreign body. And among the adults, it is the meat bones. In this picture, this is actually a fish bone which was removed from the esophagus. Among the older population, dentures are also very common. This is the rigid esophagoscope which we use with the light source, which we use for removing the foreign body within the esophagus. And this is a picture of an ENT surgeon removing the foreign body in the theater. And this esophagoscope has got gradations on it so that we will know at which level we have removed the foreign body from. Now, this is another emergency which we encounter at least once a month in our center. Once a month or probably twice a month in our center, and which needs immediate treatment. Mucormycosis per se is the fungal infection caused by a species, rhizopus species. So this is usually the picture which we get. The patient will present to us with a unilateral swelling, facial swelling, and they will have a severe headache on one side. Nasal obstruction may or may not be there. And some patients may have nasal discharge or nasal bleeding. In many cases, this blackish eschar will not be seen. They'll just have only the facial swelling and the severe headache. Only when you do a nasal endoscopy, you will come to know that inside there are some blackish eschar, which is classic pathognomonic sign of mucormycosis. It is usually seen in immunocompromised patients and elderly patients who have uncontrolled diabetes. So when we see such patients, what we have to do is we have to remove a bit of the blackish eschar from here and send it for an immediate urgent fungal staining. And when the fungal staining, and we wait for the report, and when the fungal staining comes as broad aseptate hyphae, it means that we have a case of mucormycosis and we need to do something now. So what we do is we plan for an endoscopic debridement and functional endoscopic surgery under GA. That is, we remove out the entire portion of the fungal infection endoscopically as well as from external region also. Because if you don't remove the entire region and if you are going to start the patient directly on antifungal, it is not going to help. We have to remove it under most of the patients. We have to take the patients under general anesthesia, remove the entire fungal debris, and then start the patient on liposomal amphotericin B, which the patient has to have around a cumulative dose of about 2 gram amphotericin B in a span of 3 weeks. Now, apart from these, there are some more emergencies which present in ENT, emergencies of the special senses. Like the patient, if we don't treat the patient on time, he may lose his hearing or he may lose his vision. Like, the first one is, there will be progressive loss of vision in some cases when the patient presents with an orbital abscess or an orbital hematoma. The second one is the sudden sensorineural hearing loss. So we'll go with one by one. Coming first to the orbital hematoma or orbital abscess, you can see that in this, the patient will present with a unilateral proptosis. The patient will have headache on one side, unilateral headache, will have fever, and the most important thing, the patient will have progressive loss of vision. And when we know that the patient is having progressive loss of vision, we need to act quickly because we need to do something surgically. So before that, we need to do a CT scan. When we do a CT and we get a picture that you can see that in this patient over here, in this region, there is a collection within the orbit. So this is actually a subperiosteal abscess within the orbit, and this has to be removed. So that is when we plan for an emergency endoscopic orbital decompression. So this is a patient. You can see that this patient is presented with a unilateral proptosis, and you can see the pus, it's an orbital abscess. The CT scan shows there's infection within the sinuses. It has breached the orbit over here. It has entered into the orbit. You can see the pus over here. The patient has underwent an endoscopic decompression. We go through the nose, into the orbit, remove the lacrimal bone, into the orbit, and then we incise that area and remove the pus. And once and post-operatively, the patient will have an improved state. But the fact is, when we come to know that the patient is having loss of vision, we have to act quickly. That is, we have a golden period of 24 hours. Within the 24 hours, if you are able to take up the patient and do the surgery, we will be able to save the vision of the patient. If not, patient might symptomatically be better, but we are not sure whether the patient will get back his vision. Now the last one, last topic for the day, that is the sudden sensorineural hearing loss. This is fairly seen in our, commonly seen in our ENT practice. Not really common, but the thing is that the patient, because many of the time patient will not come on time. The patient presents to us at a later date. But classically, the patient has some few features. That is, the patient loses his hearing. It will always be unilateral hearing all of a sudden. And not only that he has lost his hearing, he will also say that he has got tinnitus. And always both the symptoms will be together. Unilateral, sudden loss of hearing with tinnitus. And when we do an audiogram, we will get a picture like this. We'll see that this is the right ear. We'll see that the patient has lost around 60 to 70 dB hearing loss at such a short interval. Okay? And we can see that the left side is normal, but the right side is affected. So now these patients have to be put on some treatment. That is, he needs an immediate IV steroid dosage. If the patient comes within the first 48 hours after the onset of symptoms, we can save the hearing of the patient. That is, we start the patient, that is a protocol which we follow, is that we give them 1 gram methylprednisolone, IV, in 100 ml saline, which we will repeat for 3 consecutive days. We'll have for 3 days. And after that, the patient has to be on tablet prednisolone, 1 milligram per kg body weight, we start them on, for the next 3 weeks, and we reduce it with a tapering dose. If the patient presents after the 48 hours, and after 48 hours, even then we do give this steroids, but most of the time we are not able to save the hearing of the patient. But if we can do it within the first 48 hours, we can get back absolutely normal hearing of the patient. Only the constraint is that if the patient is diabetic, we have to admit the patient and monitor the glucose levels of the patient.
Thank you, Dr. Anup Chandra.
What is the cause of this?
In most of the cases, it's always a viral infection. And for that time, we not use it. We along with the steroid, we also give acyclovir also for the 3 weeks.
Second, can you Can you refer to the weather?
I have a question. Yes, yes. No other, no other.
I request Dr. Shavulovich to handle this. I sincerely thank all the members who have participated and also the sponsors who have been kind enough to sponsor our program. Thank you.